basically defines predefined keys in the cryptographic sequence that are known to the chip will enter the debug mode. Okay, it's fair enough. So if you see these keys, then you have a debug connection and then you have to deal with it. I said, okay, it's fine. Both sides say we are now debugging, not a big deal. The only problem is it ended up not only the chip has to know about them, also the host deck has to deal with them, which means the host deck sees these debug keys, which is kind of bad since they have to do the right handling. If you trust a debug key, then you basically trust a debug key. But then I said, okay, if one device then gets out of debug mode, then the debug keys gets invalid. Wrong. The specification says only one side has to enter the debug mode and the other side has to follow, which kind of, why? And yeah, because we have to, it's complicated with the UI on the headsets to actually sell them to debug mode. You're debugging something. If they have to press a Morse code to get into debug mode, I don't care. It's not for general use, it's for the engineers. Nope, they want it easy for everybody. So remember, for any people that implement a host deck, you really have to take the debug link keys seriously because they are a big security risk. I tried to tell them that's wrong and I don't care, but they ended up, this is the specification how it stands today. Oh, and by the way, I've seen some early chips that got confused. Once you have enabled debug mode and then switch out of debug mode, then they still produce debug keys all over. But never mind. But that's probably fixed by now. Okay. Bluetooth 2.1 is out since middle of the year. I haven't seen any device so far, and every time I speak to actually companies that work on Bluetooth 2.1 stacks and Bluetooth 2.1 wires, they are scared. They don't want to put it out on the market. Nobody wants to go first. They're testing interop with old devices, and they're testing the complete functionality, and they have a big problem. The chip manufacturers have all 2.1 ready chips, but none of them is actually really selling them. I think CSR is selling some of them, but I haven't seen that in any product. And they even don't have a firmware release they consider from the quality-wise stable enough to actually do it and announce it officially. Microsoft has a stack, Broadcom has a stack which supports 2.1. They both are not convinced that they're going to release it, so I don't know what happens. Apple is not doing it at all, what I know from a current standpoint. The Linux side is fun, since the first stack I had ready something a year ago, then the Bluetooth stick decided to change the specification completely, so that implementation was invalid. Then I tried it again with a beta specification. It ended up being full of security holes when I did the audit on it, and currently I'm working on the third generation of the Bluetooth 2.1 implementation to get it actually right, and I have no idea when it will be ready for mainline consumptions. So, I have no idea when we see the first devices. My guess is a keyboard, a really simple keyboard, would be the first device we're going to see, but who knows. Okay, just to sum up the possible issues which 2.1 involves, the debug mode, it's a big one. If that goes screwed up, then you basically have really weak devices. The interop with old devices has such a high priority in the whole specification that I don't know if they always get this right. As I showed, the complexity gets more in the host deck, so, and you know what happens if manufacturers have to do all them by themselves, they screwed up. They screwed up even with the older Bluetooth profiles, which was pretty simple. I know they have to do even more to make it secure. I don't know. The higher level protocols actually can do a security evaluation and change the behavior, what they have to do again, etc., etc. I mentioned it, the missing I/O capabilities don't enforce a disconnect or rejection, so you basically can get away with it and expect an authenticated combination key, but in the end you get an unauthenticated combination key and you go along and you are basically not protected against man-in-the-middle attacks, which is kind of okay. If you want that protection and the other side can't surf it, then you basically have to disconnect. But then you go again, the usability, oh no, we can't disconnect because the reason is not visible, not easy to display to the user, whatever. The specification changed in the last months before it was released so many times, and it still changes because of the additional erratas, because they did the wording wrong, they had ambiguity in some of the paragraphs and so on and so forth. So it's, you really have to look closely to see what you have to do if you deal with it. Okay, 3.0 and later. It's fun, it gets better and better. So at some point 2.1 should be the standard for doing security within Bluetooth. And it's pretty good standard once we get the Hostack implementations right, which I currently doubt that it will happen anytime soon, so at least another 2 years. So 3.0 is targeted for the end of next year. It will introduce something that's called AMP, Alternate MAC and FileAir. So they wanted to go high speed and decided, okay, yeah, we don't do our own radio again, so we use either ultra wideband or IEEE 802.11. The interesting part is both come with their own security models. Because we can protect the Bluetooth radio quite good, but if you do ultra wideband or Wi-Fi, you have to protect that too. And we know in the Wi-Fi case how that worked out. And they're working on their own security models to protect the Wi-Fi link and the ultra wideband link, and they will end up in having additional link keys that can be used with the Bluetooth stack. So it's all work in progress. They're discussing it forth and back. But at some point, there are too many Wi-Fi companies that had no idea how security works, are actually making proposals, which you see, okay, that's simply wrong, that won't work. Never mind. Ultra low power, AKA Vibri. So Nokia did the smart move and sold it to the Bluetooth 6, so the Bluetooth 6 has no deal with it to make a proper specification out of it. It's 2.4 gigahertz radio, but it's totally different baseband. Calling it Bluetooth is absolutely wrong because it has nothing to do with Bluetooth. It's some whipped up radio protocol designed in some Nokia research center in Helsinki, designed by people that get paid for doing weird stuff and know they try to make a product out of it. It is really that way. The security is kind of same as this with Zigbee. Oh, we do this later. Yeah, I'm not kidding. It is this way. I would never put this on a slide, but basically there was something, okay, we have to do a protection there, and we use some checksum algorithm, yada, yada, yada. Guys, you can actually brute force this. It takes something like 2 hours. Okay, then we double the bit rate. That's not what I meant. It only takes longer. And I can do it in a week, but it takes probably 2 weeks or something like that. I'm not kidding. They are thinking about stuff like that, but I hope that at some point they get some sense into it and say, okay, we have to be at least same secure as 2.1 will do, so they have to do something. A lot of people say ultra low power is not even needed, but that's a marketing requirement for some more chips to sell or whatever. And most companies don't even want to do ultra low power, they only do it because Nokia pays for it. Never mind. Okay, conclusions. Since I probably have more than 5 minutes less, so I'm not that bad in time. Bluetooth 2.1 is a big step in the right direction. The only problem is the big companies have to get it right. So we have to get a Linux stack that works perfectly. We have to get the Microsoft stack working perfectly. And once Apple and other companies jump on it and actually have stacks, they have to work. The only problem with that is there are no security audits for what actually comes out of it. The Bluetooth SIG has this big testing and qualification and so on, but they don't check if the security actually works. They check basic functionality. That's a big problem. And there's no plans what I've seen that they're going to do this. The big complexity of the new design is always a problem, and the bigger, the more complex the specification gets, the more cases you actually screw it up, and this is what I expect to see happen. There are no really easy use cases that can be generalized. So basically for all the implementers of a host stack that runs on a desktop PC on an embedded system can be used for different cases, for different scenarios, they have a hard time to get this right. If I have to design a keyboard, that's simple. If I have to design a headset, that's simple. If I have to design a multi-purpose stack, then the problem comes up. And that's basically what the Linux side has to do, what Microsoft has to do, what Apple has to do. And I'm not really looking forward in finding out what actually works and what doesn't work. Okay, that's from my talk. There was a donkey at some point from the usability issues, which is kind of a nice story, but I open this for questions now. Go ahead.
I've seen last week on YouTube there was a nice video about some US American university.
The shaking? You want me to speak about the shaking part? Okay. Okay, he just mentioned about the, I think it was last week's, it goes to all the new stickers and was on YouTube. They had a new way to do actually the pairing. Basically, it's kind of out of band mechanism. So you take your phone and probably another phone, borrow your phone, and you do something like this long enough and then it's paired because they shake in a basic same frequency and that's enough to pair. Actually, the idea is nice. We will see. It's definitely with 2.1, it's possible to implement this kind of out-of-band algorithm to do it. I have no idea if they're going to do it, if someone's accepting them, or if you people see pairing and sitting in the airport and pairing their devices. I don't know. Yeah, he mentioned that you need additional hardware. The phones always get a motion sensor nowadays. The OpenMoco gets a motion sensor, the iPhone has a motion sensor, and it's getting more and more phones get this. I have actually no idea how this answer, but the idea is kind of nice. So maybe if someone is bored, they're probably going to really implement it with a real device. Any other questions, comments? Okay, if NFC would work out as a pairing mechanism. NFC will work out. NFC is actually quite nice and good enough. The only problem with RFC, it's still RFID. So if you think it only works in a distance of a centimeter or two, you're mistaken. If you put a big enough antenna on it, you can read it from a more wide distance. The second of all, getting devices with... Wait a second. Wait until your talk. Getting devices with NFC support. Nokia talks about NFC for paying with your mobile phone in trams or trains or whatever since 2 years. These devices never make it on the market so far. The chips, somehow they're not good enough, but I haven't seen this making on the market. Yeah, I've seen that model too, but... I never said they not exist, but they're not mass market. Nokia has one model. That's the only company that actually has a model. Okay, so...
This is also actually back to the near-field communication. There's no security. You can spoof it. You can clone it. And especially, I have one of these Nokia phones with an embedded RFID reader, and this is just... it's just the EEPROM reader. It's clear text, it's not encrypted, it's not secure, you can clone it, you can spoof it, and you can do anything with it. So near-field communication has to be done with the same type of security. You cannot do it simple. Otherwise, I just clone your tag and get in and get the key.
As I said, it's absolutely true, but we have to see how this works out, and still people think more about usability than actually security. There was another question somewhere. Yes, please. Okay, but there's no implementation in the stack whatsoever. There are prototypes of the stack, which Microsoft and some other companies go testing with on the Unplug events, which are covered by an NDA. I don't see anyone of getting out and say, okay, can we now do it? Apple said to me, no, we are busy. We are doing something else. The Linux implementation, which I'm working on, is, yeah, it's not ready yet because there are too many factors I have to think about to get it right. And I don't want to push something that is half ready and basically someone comes along and does an audit on it and it breaks behind my back. Same goes for the other companies. They're really afraid, and I haven't seen anything coming out, and nobody has a commitment to 2.1, neither an embedded device, neither an host stack somewhere. Everybody is working on it, but the last things I heard, they're targeting end of next year to have them, which is actually kind of bad. Any other questions? And thanks from my side, and I open the space for the next speaker.